Today we're going to talk about butt plates for the Woodsrunner. If you watched the previous video, we talked about machining butt plates rather than using castings in order that they fit, you know, more precisely and don't require fitting and they don't vary in shape and size, so forth and so on. So we have a little bit, this video is just an update on that process. So we've been having pretty good success with machining butt plates. There's still some work to do, but I thought I'd just bring you along to show you a little bit of how it happens. So it's kind of neat. It's kind of an unusual part to machine, and maybe not the easiest part to machine. So to start out, I'll show you what one looks like. Here's one that we made just recently. It's been machined. Side, you can see it. There's probably a little tweaking with it, but it's not too bad right now. You know, it's pretty good.
How does it compare with a casting that someone would get?
So, in terms of a casting, I'd say that right now the surface finish might be comparable. You know, both need to be polished. Here's a casting. There's a machine part. So the actual surface finish, you know, might be comparable, but the difference is in the size and shape. So the machine version is much more consistent in size and shape. Butt plates can be a little tricky for people to inlet on a kit because castings do vary. And to get a really good fit can sometimes be a little tricky. Especially if you don't have a lot of experience with that sort of thing. So that's why we've gone to machining butt plates rather than using the casting. So that they'll basically be fit right on without any adjustments to the wood. This looks pretty good. There are still some tool marks a little bit, so it still requires sanding to polish it up to make it look at its optimum. And we, over time, we'll probably get a little bit better finish, do a little bit better, but it's not like, you know, some people will probably take this and just use it as is. But in order to be nice, you'd really want to sand it first. Going back into kind of the process of making these, they start with the process of machining them. They start with a sand casting. And you can think of starting with a sand cast preform. Its cross section is basically looks like this. So this is just a little loose pattern that we made. It's a little L-shaped piece, and you can see that the butt plate will fit inside that cross section. I don't know if you can see or not. So in order to make the starting sand casting, we have a little furnace, a little small melting furnace, and we've just been making some sand molds and pouring them ourselves. We probably won't do that for the long term, but for just you know, getting going, making some material to get the process figured out, it works okay. So we've just been using this little loose pattern. We just have some oil sand and just been making open molds, open top molds, and just pouring in the open mold, and it's worked pretty good. Worked well enough anyway for what we need to do. So these are the preforms we're using to machine butt plates. This is not going to be a permanent way that we make them. These are just an open top mold, and they're not very efficient, not great yield out of them, that sort of thing. But for trials, it'll work well. We won't pour them here when we go into full production. We'll have a brass foundry do it, but for trying things out, this works well for us. So after we have castings that basically look like this, now they won't be quite as tall, they're cut down a little bit, they're only about that deep. Just wide enough for a butt plate, a little over 2 inches wide. And then the first step is we have to machine the inside. So you can see here, this inside has been machined.
You can see the inside of the butt plate. Now we're not concerned about
a great surface finish inside because it's basically just clearance. The areas where we're concerned about are the bits that contact the wood. You know, those areas are important. But the rest really isn't. And then, that's the first operation. And then the second operation, I'll show you the fixture it goes on here in a few, but the second operation does everything on the outside and turns it into the part that you see. So we're able to machine a butt plate in two operations using a three-axis mill with a fourth axis. So we're using a rotary axis as well.
What's been the hardest part of doing these?
So it can be tricky. So this, you can see a butt plate is very organic in shape. So developing the model can be tricky. So part of the model, I mean a 3D model, a digital model in the computer. So you need a model in order to drive the tool paths to generate the CAM files and the NC data. So developing the model can be tricky. So what we've done is we've made a model by hand and then use 3D scanning to collect the surface data, transfer that into a solid, actually turn it into a solid model. So that can be a little bit of work trying to actually get a model of your butt plate. And then this part is not the easiest part to machine. So you want to make it, we have to make it fast in order to be able to machine a butt plate, because we can't, you know, take huge amounts of time. We have to, you know, limited amount of time we can take to make these. So it has to be an efficient, good process. It's okay now, it's gonna get better. So you have to come up with a strategy of how you're gonna machine this. And it's not the easiest part to machine. You can see it's thin-walled and goofy shaped and just difficult in terms of machining parts. It's much more difficult than square objects you can hold in a vise and so forth. So it can be tricky. So that's one of the challenges. Also, like I said, getting it machined fast enough is another challenge. Right now, we're probably looking at about maybe 10 minutes per operation, op one and op two, somewhere in that range, which is not quite as fast as we want. We want to get it down to 7 or 8 minutes per operation. So the whole butt plate will maybe take 15 minutes, but we have some work to do in order to make that happen. It's not an easy part to make for sure.
Can you talk about why you pour this rather than bending a piece of brass?
Yeah, so we originally started trying to bend some brass bar stock, bend it 90 degrees. But the problem is having enough material back here in the heel. When you start bending it, it thins out there, and you have to go to thicker and thicker material, and then it becomes more difficult to bend. So it's kind of a fighting. They're probably, you know, we also thought about then using thinner material and then upsetting it by driving, you know, forming it, pressing it in the heel, which probably can be done. I think with the right tooling, we could use bar stock or plate to make the preforms, but the castings have been pretty easy, so it's not a bad option either. And we machine other steel parts, but brass parts like nose caps and so forth, where we have a lot of scrap. So that scrap works good just to melt down. So it seems like the sand cast preforms are a pretty good option. Here's some on the gun. So the neat thing about these is that they fit very close right out of the box. So here's one that's on a gun. You can see the fit is pretty darn good. And that's really without any wood removal at all. So that's the big advantage of why we decided to machine these, is because we want to make this kit go together as easy as possible and be as nice as possible, and it's just hard to do with the cast butt plate. Even things like fitting the box to the cutout and the brass, you know, this one isn't completed yet, it's still rounded. There's a little work to do there with the program, but you know, that'll be 100% cut out. And it just makes the whole assembly process so much easier.
So this one you have here should be able to fit right under there?
Yeah, so I had it on here. But I'll put it on just so you can see it too. You can see it drops right on there. We'll go ahead and screw it on.
There's no wood removal you did or anything to prep that. That's just...
So this one, the first stocks that we've made, they have a little bit of... Let me show you here. So one thing neat is they've got this hump, this little mountain. And what that does is that fixes the position of the butt plate so it can't move around left to right, which is a real good way of doing it. And this hill is just a tiny bit too big. So, and these will be adjusted before they go out the door, but the first ones that had to be spotted in a tiny bit just so this mountain, this hill here was small enough that the butt plate was able to come down. So we'll make that adjustment and make them the future stocks, but the stocks we already have made, we'll make those adjustments by hand before they go out the door. But yeah, there shouldn't be any wood removal at all that'll be required with these butt plates. So I just used a little transfer color and trimmed it a little bit so this would come down far enough. And if I say a little bit, I'm probably talking like, you know, 5 thousandths or 10 thousandths maximum. Holes will be in the stock. Okay. You can see it just nestles into place. I'm trying to rely on a wood screw for locating, you know, especially like kind of like left to right, you know, or side to side on the stock isn't good. That's why the wood is fit to the inside of the butt plate. A lot of originals are made that way as well. And you don't have such dead space inside, so the screws start to grab onto wood much quicker, and you don't have to have as long of a screw. It's just a better system in general. And then this screw goes here. And that's all there is to it. Like I said, this will all be cut out for the dovetail for the box, so it shouldn't require any fitting at all either. So it's been a tricky process getting it up and going, but I think it's gonna work. And I think it's gonna be a real huge addition to the kit. Just gonna have to do some more work and trying to get cycle time down so it doesn't take quite as long as it currently is. Some details to work out, but it looks like it's gonna be okay.
And this one, just because you can see it in the video, this was like a test because it's got the holes in it.
Yeah, so this one here, probably shouldn't have had it here. That was some ones that we poured. It had some slag inclusions. So they didn't clean up. That's one of the first ones we did just because we knew that usually you mess something up, which we did. We messed up a little bit of the machining over here too. I didn't see that. But on a sample, so one of the first ones that we did. So. The first ones, you always pick ones that have defects and you're not wasting a good piece. So, yeah, that wouldn't be in the final versions.
You want to show me the fixture?
Yeah, so we'll walk over there to the machine. Okay. So we're inside a machine right now, a CNC machine. This is a Haas machine with a fourth axis rotary. So you can show the fourth axis. And there's a big trunnion that comes out from it. So it works well we're able to use four axes on a lot of parts at once. It's a pretty good size machine, VM4. But anyway, in here you can kind of see how this rotates, as well as the spindle goes up and down. Table moves left, right, front to back. So four axes. So you can see the fixture, how it holds the part. So this would be how it would be after it was completed. So before, just the inside of the machine here. I don't know if this one will fit or not because it's a little oversized. So it would go on here like this. I guess it's going in there. And the holes will be drilled first. Put some temporary screws in to hold it in place on this fixture.
Are the holes drilled by hand or with the machine?
They're drilled with the machine. So there's a little strap clamp that holds it down, holes are drilled,
counter board, machine screws hold it to the fixture, and then the whole business is machine. So that's kind of the highlights of it. This isn't a permanent fixture. This is our first one we made. There's a few things that we want to change with it, but all in all, it's gonna be okay.
So we're over here in the office with Justin, one of our relatively new employees, and he does a lot of the programming, CNC programming, and you can see a model of the butt plate. It's pretty wild how you can see it in three dimensions, and it's actually a digital version of the actual three-dimensional object. So one thing that's a little bit tricky, like I mentioned, is developing the model for an object that has a very organic shape. And some of this was modeled kind of directly in the CAD system, and some of it was, like I said, was 3D scanned and then turned to surfaces with various software. That's the model of the butt plate. And then turn on the fixture here. So that's the fixture that allows us to hold the model after first operation. So the first operation cuts the backside, like I mentioned, and currently it's just held in a vise. We're able to get it done. Maybe not the best solution, but it works. But the second operation is proven to be pretty good. So if you kind of turn off the butt plate, maybe you can see what the inside of the fixture looks like. So it allows the butt plate to nestle in there and then be held with the holes that ordinarily hold the butt plate to the stock. So it provides some pretty rigid work holding and allows us to make this thin part kind of a shell and does a pretty good job of it. So we can show a little simulation that might be neat.
Makes it look so easy.
Yeah. The simulations are a very valuable part of the software that you can look and see what the tools are doing ahead of time and get an idea how the part is going to look. It saves a lot of problems out on the floor.
So this is the second operation because the first already would have been
The first done. Would be inside of the butt plate. We'll show it too. But we'll probably do something a little more sophisticated at some point with that as well. First operation. Plunging an end mill down, get rid of some material. That kind of sticks out and is unsupported, so a plunge mill works pretty well in that case. A little bit of what's called adaptive cutting along the top. Again, it's not well supported up top right now. And the adaptive are pretty light cuts that don't influence the material that much. So now it's cutting the inside, coming down with a contour cut, rough, and then finish. Be a little gentle with this bit that sticks out because it isn't held as securely as we might like. What happens if you don't hold something securely? You get vibration, chatter, bad finishes. Now it's starting to hollow out the bottom part of the butt plate. Just kind of pretty big step over getting rid of that material. Inside of the butt plate where it contacts the wood. It's hard to keep up with, I'm sure, but still kind of neat. That must be it.
That's it.
So we'll go ahead and walk out the floor and we'll take a look at the fixture and show you how the butt plate goes on.